big nail bar stool. Nails done.
Well, that was on the film.
Right.
Okay. So, you are recording. Yeah.
So I've rolled out lots of pieces of clay and I've painted them, and then I've scratched into them, lots of Sgraffito. Then I've rolled them out again to kind of get rid of all the rough edges, and then I leave them to dry out. And they don't dry out completely. I have to kind of wait until they're just malleable and I can still bend them. So once they're at this stage, I then shape everything. And it's really important that when I shape them, I'm not smudging the colours. So it's got to be at a stage where the colours are sort of fixed. Otherwise everything smudges and I get fingerprints and it all looks a bit rubbish. So I shape everything quickly. And then I start to put them all together. The longest thing is doing the slabs. That takes forever to roll them out, cut out the shapes, get the colour on, make them all kind of happy and just kind of as I want them really. And I'll do sort of batches of maybe three and then work in threes, put them together. So the quickest bit is putting everything together. But if I'm doing a batch of pieces, it will probably take about 3 weeks from start to finish. From rolling out to making, firing them, glazing them, firing them again. So it's about a 3 week turnaround, if I'm lucky. It's a very large kiln, so it can be longer. Depends how I'm kind of, if I'm on go fast or go slow really. So I kind of pinch, lots of pinching and shaping, and I try not to manipulate the shapes too much. I try and let the pattern dictate what's going on. So I am just going to shape all my pieces, sort of pre-form pieces, so that they are kind of almost the shape they're going to be as I put them together, but they're still malleable enough to kind of move them about if I need to. If I leave it too long, they'll dry out and I can't do anything with them. So, I've got a pair of legs, and I've got a pair of front legs and a pair of back legs, and they're the ones that need to be kind of nice and strong, otherwise the whole piece will fall over, which is no good. As I'm making, I do think about the character that I'm making, and when you've made quite a few, it becomes sort of second nature, but you're still building a character into it. You've still got this little personality that's going to come out in what you're making. And that sort of comes out in the last few pieces as you put it together with the directions and kind of how, what you want the animal to say, really. You know, is it a feisty fox? Is it a fantastic Mr. Fox? Is it fat fox? I'm going for my Fs. There's all sorts of bits and pieces in there. And it's just, there's something so nice just squishing little bits of the clay and it finding its own little place. It just kind of settles into its own little shape. And I kind of, you know, I've cut these shapes so there's very little of me having to form it. I've kind of done all that already.
But what you have done is to develop the pattern over a number of years. So, yeah.
So I know what works and what doesn't work.
You know the anatomy will work.
Yes, and it is really important to know, you know, that this is an anatomically correct fox, but when it all goes together, you know that if you look at a real fox and my ceramic fox, that there are bits in there that you can see. There's that lovely arch in the back and there's the big brush on the tail. And, you know, all those bits are the character that make it fox, and it's that sort of fleetingness, that sort of capturing that little essence that I'm about, really. That's what I want. So the last piece I put together is the body, and I'm just going to go straight for it and start cross-hatching and scoring and slipping.
Well, maybe this would be a good opportunity, Anna, for me to bring the camera close up and do some close-ups of your hands.
Ooh,
okay, Anna, let's see what this comes out like.
I'm going to add on some slip and start to put Mr. Fox together. because I use paper clay, it is very forgiving, and you can do all sorts of bits. This will prove me wrong because it's been videoed.
Oh, I don't suppose so. I think you've done this before.
I might have done. So, I'll give it a bit of a bash, hold it in place, kind of get my bits in order. A bit of a tap with my wooden spatula. And just kind of, when you've got the body right, everything else comes together, but if the body's the wrong shape, you're stuffed. You're doomed. That's the problem. So I spend a lot of time kind of wiping away the excess slip. Just because it gets sharp, when it's fired, it can become quite sharp. And there's nothing like, because ceramics, you want to touch it. They're bright colours, they're shiny, you've got to touch it. And if it's sharp, then obviously it's not a good feeling. So there's my little body. I'm going to pop my legs on. So I'm going to decide where and when they're going to go. So because the clay is still malleable, I can sort of squish things in place and decide, oh yes, that looks nice there. At the moment it will look like a roast chicken. Oven ready chicken, except for the colour of course. I kind of liken everything to pieces of meat. So the front legs look like rashers of bacon, the back legs look like pork chops, and it just kind of helps me remember what I'm doing, even though it won't be a chicken or a pork product. So a bit more cross-hatching. He's going to go, I think, there. So it's always really important to slip and score the pieces that you're joining. Paper clay, you can get away with not doing an awful lot of joining and an awful lot of slipping. It is a magic type of clay, and it's very forgiving. But it's very, I'd say the only downside is it stinks when you fire it. The paper fibres are just revolting. So at the moment I have a body with a pair of legs. So this is my alien pod shape. So I'm going to do a bit of measuring, a bit of squishing, a bit of squeezing, a bit of tapping. There's that fly. Can you hear him? He's back. So I'm going to score, and so originally when I used to make these, I used to close all the little gaps up, but I like gaps, and a lot of people get very kind of weird about gaps. Why is it a hole? Why is there a hole? And I like the fact that it has a hole, because your brain will automatically fill it in.
I remember you telling me about some of your foxes which don't have a top on their heads.
Yeah.
But they're still foxes.
They still look like foxes. Yeah. You know, it's not a real fox, it's a fox shape. And it's just, your brain goes, yeah, it's a fox, you know. And you don't often get a blue cat, but people know it's a cat. So that's my theory, and I think it works.
Oh, you get blue whippets, though.
Yeah, but they're not kind of that blue, are they? That's very blue. So I'm just putting this little pillow together using my special stick. So my stick is like a third hand. Kind of when you do jewellery, you have an extra pair of tweezers that helps do things as a third hand. And that's my stick. Sticks are really important. So we've got one bit of neck, and I'm going to do another bit. So I'm sort of trying to build up my hunch. So I've got a bit of poking, a bit of squishing and squashing. Decide who's going to go where. But I do kind of very much look at just what is there already, rather than try and make it into what isn't there. And sometimes I think it would be really nice to be even more abstract. and just have just a lump for a leg and just a, you know, really kind of strip it really down loads. But I'm stuck in a rut with this at the moment, and I think it, you know, people like these. I'd like to make them more kind of abstract and find that inner Picasso.
Cubist foxes.
Yeah, lots of triangles.
Yeah.
Just a blob and a shape. And it's a cat. You know, you can do that with figures, can't you? You can just go, that's a head, that's a, you know, that's that. And, well, and people accept it.
Picasso did manage to make animals out of the fewest of lines, didn't
they? Absolutely. And yeah.
And they were immediately recognisable as a bull or whatever.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And you look at it and you just go, yeah, that's that, isn't it? It's like a child's drawing. If a child shows you a picture and goes, that's you, mummy, and that's the cat, you just go, oh, yeah, of course it is. And you can see it. And it's kind of going, reverting back to that. And I just love that simplicity. It's just, yeah. Simplicity and colour. That's me, really. As long as it's colourful, I'm happy.
Yeah, definitely colour.
So, I'm going to stick my front legs on. Got a weird front leg here. Short front legs, this one. He's only little. So I'm going to work out where to put them. Best place to put them, and then just stick them on.
We're going to have people looking at the video and thinking, what's happened to all the hairs in the background?
Yeah,
that
just
have
depleting.
Been disappearing.
Where have they gone? So I'm going to pop these on. I'll try and do it facing you so you can see what I'm doing.
Oh, that's very kind of you.
I know, otherwise you just sort of see the back, don't you? It's all a bit boring.
Well, I don't know. It's quite a foxy back.
Yeah. So a bit of squishing and squashing. Without undoing that much too much. A bit more slip. The clay is, and also the other downside with paper clay is it does dry out really quickly because it's got so much paper in it. So when you've got a shape and it starts to dry, and you want it to be a bit more malleable, you do have to keep spraying. Which can be a bit of a pain.
Oh, his poor neck's opened up.
Has he opened up?
He has a bit.
No longer. There, he's had some surgery. And he looks fine now. Right, let's put that bit on there. Squeeze. The nice thing is that you hear the clay. There's some funny little noises it makes, lots of sort of squelchy, squeezy noises. And when you're tapping it, it's a lovely hollow sound. Yeah. And it's just something really nice about that, the touch and feel of it. And you don't get it with any other material, really. There is something particularly fantastic about clay. And I always think it's like kind of being with an old friend. You just sort of click straight back into it, and it's just lovely, really. Until it goes wrong.
I can't imagine that ever happened.
No, man would never go.
No.
There's a recycling bin for things going wrong. Right, I'm going to stick his tail on. So his tail, I'm going to move him round, and his tail is going to sit and kind of form the last part of his spine. So he needs to go that way. And then whilst I can still get in here, I'm going to sort of give it a bit of a squish. So that will fit on there nicely and cover up any little gaps that might be down there. Bit of cross-hatching. Little bit on here. So there's something really nice about making patterns in clay and then putting them together with the colour. And it's just, on each fox you'll find something that you just think, oh, that's gorgeous. The way those two go together, and you can't plan it. You know, when I'm painting the shapes, I know that the tip of the tail will be white, and I know that there'll be a bit of white on the chest, but that's about it really. So here's Mr. Fox with a very thin head. So I've got my tail on, and he looks quite happy. And I'm going to do the last bit of neck, and I'm going to have him so he's facing his tail. So he's got a bit more sort of direction going on, and then his head. So there's a nice curve going on, and that will sort of make me feel happy that there's a good shape sort of coming through. So let's do a bit of cross hatching.
I was just about to say it was very feline, but I guess it's
And I think foxes are very feline, and sort of you hear about reports of sort of cats and foxes in gardens, and they very rarely fight. They seem to sort of respect each other. They're not the same family. They do definitely come from the dog family, but there are so many similarities. Kind of the way they sit, the way they hunt, just lots of things really that are very similar. And they do, you know, they do a great job catching rats. Mm. You forget that they catch rats and how yucky rats are. I think we need to praise the rat catcher. So he's going to be kind of leaning over that way, kind of permanently wiping off my mucky fingerprints. And then I'm going to get my head on, so he's got a nice shape going on. So pop him. It's funny, some people cross hatch with toothbrushes, which I find I can't deal with that. Just the thought of toothbrush on a clay on a toothbrush is just but I don't think you've got enough kind of, it's not roughed up enough with a toothbrush. It's got to be a knife. No. And there are certain knives.
Such aggression, Anna. I can't believe it.
No, there's just something about the way the blade works. You know, I think each person has their tools that they're really happy with. And yeah, it's got to be a potter's knife. So my little Mr. Foxy is kind of going to go that way. So you can see he's got a nice sort of twist to him.
He does.
So I'm going to cross-hatch the bits that are going to stick and leave the other bits. And I'm just going to leave gaps and holes and things. So he's going to have a gap in his chest and a gap at the back of his head. His brains and his heart won't fall out. It'll be fine. Let's see. And then I'll get his ears on. He's a nice inquisitive fox. Let's have a look at him that way. So he's got one ear bigger than the other. Haven't we all?
I think he might have been in a fight.
He could have been in a fight. In fact, if I turn him round, that might even be better. Oh, perfect. Right, okay, so I'm going to put... Ears are always the bits that want to fall off, because they're the smallest.
So they don't have much of a joining surface.
No, there isn't
they?
A lot there. Yeah. It's just. Let's stick you on there, Malachi. Squidge you all down. So one ear. So I never use water, partly because obviously I would lose the colour, that would all mix in and go yucky. But also I want to keep those edges. I want to see where I've joined everything, and it's kind of about those components that have made up something. So for me, it's the importance of decorating before constructing. And if I do it the other way is fine, but you haven't got that. Each thing just then becomes something new. And I like the newness of it. So you're gonna go there. So you can see what I'm doing. It's going to pop on there. So hopefully, he's a happy little fox.
He does look it.
He does look kind of well looked after. And I'm going to give him a couple of eyes, which I have to face him this way, I'm afraid. But he's going to have...
Well, I'm sure he'll turn around this way and have a look
he'll
at me in a moment. Yeah.
He might even... He's got a pair of eyes and he's got some nostrils. He's got a nice little mouth. And there he is, one Mr. Fox. Get the sharp bits off.
He's rather beautiful.
And hopefully that will all stick together and it won't fall apart.
That would be good. That would be good.
So I'm just tidying up a little bit, taking off the excess slip so it's not too lumpy. When it fires, it goes a bit sharp. So it's just to soften those edges. But he's pretty much done, really. He's hopefully just all complete and quite happy. I've done his claws, get rid of any sharp bits, and his tail. So yeah, he's done. That's my fantastic Mr. Fox.
So could you give us a slow twirl of
yes.
Mr. Fox?
Yes, of course I can.
Yeah.
He's got quite a pointy little face, hasn't he?
Yeah, I think he looks like he's watching a bee or a wasp or something flying around.
There was a fly in here.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. That's probably what it was watching.
That's him looking at his fly. So I think, yeah, I'm kind of quite happy with him, and he'll go and sit with the other one.
Thank you, Anna. That was really nice.
That's okay.
And it's so nice to see somebody breathing life into some clay.
From flat pieces.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Right, so we've got Jessica, Jules, Chris, Jill, Debbie, Sue. Susan goes next week. Margaret's has gone, Debbie's gone, Jill's gone, Chris is next week, Jules has gone, Jessica's gone. We'll go for that one.
Okay, I'll give that one.
Sure. Now, did she make some? No, because she hasn't done the hair one before, and I did a hair workshop, so I need to take them on.